Welcome all to yet another video section of Dr. RS and you on science of cosmetics and personal care products. Today we are continuing building blocks actives, which is the 26th part, and today dandruff. We will discuss about dandruff, right? So skin moisturization, we discuss active skin moisturization, management of prickly heat, acne, and now the dandruff, right? So today dandruff part 26, building blocks, actives, dandruff. Okay, now dandruff is a skin condition, right, that mainly affects scalp. Symptoms include flaking and sometimes mild itchiness, right? This is dandruff. Dandruff is a skin condition that mainly affects scalp. Symptoms include flaking and sometimes mild itchiness, right? You can already see markings here, no? See, I am sitting and recording the video alone. See what happens, no? Sometimes there was a recording that I have not started the recording, and I am keeping on talking and finally find out that I have not started the recording. Something like that happens in the middle. That's why I have to re-record. So when I was explaining before, I was doing all these things, now I am again explaining, doesn't matter, that is why all these lines again. So anatomy and physiology of the scalp, very important. Dandruff mainly affects the scalp, not the hair, it's the scalp, right? It is important to note that healthy hair begins with healthy scalp. The hair grows below the skin of the scalp with follicles protected in subcutaneous fat covering the scalp. The scalp has abundant blood supply to provide the necessary nutrients for the hair growth, and extensive nerve network also, right? This is why injuries to the scalp bleed profusely and are quite painful. In addition to blood vessels and nerves, the scalp also has numerous eccrine sweat gland and sebaceous glands. Numerous eccrine sweat gland and sebaceous glands, right? What is eccrine sweat gland? It's the gland which is present from time of your birth itself, the eccrine sweat glands. The other sweat gland is apocrine sweat gland that is formed only after puberty. So eccrine sweat gland is mainly electrolytes and sebaceous gland. So see, now so scalp these secretions, what secretions? The eccrine secretions and sebaceous gland secretions, right? These secretions provide nutrients for bacteria and fungus that can infect the skin of the scalp, right? That can infect the skin of the scalp. So much, every hair has sebaceous glands along with it, and apart from that, there is eccrine sweat gland that provides moisture. So along with the moisture, the fat, and the hair also increases the chance of infection by providing abundant surface area for the organisms to grow. So the sebum, the fat is there, the sweat is there, moisture is there, and good surface area is there. Lastly, sweat can function as an irritant, accounting for frequent itching associated with the areas of sweat collection, such as nape of the neck. The presence of neural network around the hairs also provide more opportunities for sensation of itching, right? Sensation of itching, right? This is the hair, right? This is a picture of the hair, where this is the hair, a follicle, no? Hair for, this is below, it's inside the scalp, right? This is, see, this is the sebaceous gland. Every hair follicle is associated with a sebaceous gland. These are all muscles, melanocytes, which gives color to the hair, right? We discuss the structure of the hair when we studied the hair. No? Now, scalp, dandruff. The scalp is the site of many dermatologic disease, right? Most common is dandruff. Dandruff lies on a spectrum between occasional mild flaking of the scalp to thick oozing plagues devoid of hair known as seborrheic dermatitis. Sebum causing it seborrheic dermatitis. This is the advanced stage, right, of infection. Both the conditions are caused by the same fungal organism named Melassezia globosa, right? This is the organism, right? We will, so remember this, Melassezia globosa. This fungal organism is present in the outside air, no, outside environment, and it's always in the scalp, but under certain conditions it starts growing disproportionately and cause problems, right? This fungal organism is present in the air and lands on the scalp, rich in sebum. Scalp is rich in sebum. It consumes sebum, leaves behind free fatty acids that are extremely irritating to the scalp. These free fatty acids induce itching, inflammation, and increase the scalp skin turnover, resulting in flaking. Again here, cell turnover increase and the flaking happens. So the normal dynamic process of cell turnover in the scalp is getting altered, so you get flaking, and because of this free fatty acid you also get the itching, right? Now we just causes, no, dandruff may have several causes, including irritated oily scalp, dry scalp during winter when the scalp becomes dry, sensitive to hair care products, contact dermatitis, right? You might use a hair oil where the perfume doesn't suit you. You might use a shampoo, some ingredients it will not suit, conditioner, something is not suiting. You have to be very careful. Use products which suit you, right? Simple thing, asafoetida, no? Hing, asafoetida, doesn't suit me, right? So common things which is suitable for everybody doesn't suit somebody. So once you are looking for it, you can live healthy. Most of our problems are due to something we are applying or eating which doesn't suit us. So find out what is that, right? A yeast like fungus, Melassezia, that feeds on oils on the scalp of most adults, right? Risk factors. Almost anyone can have dandruff, but certain factors can make more susceptible. What? Age. Young adulthood. and continues through middle life. That doesn't mean older adults don't get dandruff. For some people, the problem can be lifelong. Being male, because more men have dandruff, some researchers postulate male hormones may play a role. Again, the acne, dandruff, there are a lot of hypotheses, and people based on the hypothesis try to give treatment. That's why there is no permanent treatment till now for dandruff. No, either for dandruff or acne, we can only control it, because the basic cause, all most of it are postulated. Informations are coming day by day. Okay, certain illness, Parkinson's disease and other diseases that affect the nervous system, can also increase the risk of dandruff. Right, weakened immune system is also a cause of dandruff. I told you, this yeast is already there on the scalp, and when the immune system drops, the balance, it multiplies and the balance is lost, and it multiplies and causes problems. Right. So, as long as our immune system is perfect, right, everything will be in balance, all will be in balance. But once our immune system is lost, all the other things present without causing harm to us, bacteria, fungi, will start growing. So now we will see how we can address dandruff. Okay, topical antifungals is in the form of shampoos are used for reducing dandruff. Active infections can be treated with oral and topical antifungals. Now, what are the general antifungals used in personal care products? Ketoconazole. So, antifungal actives for dandruff used in shampoo. Ketoconazole, an effective antifungal. Shampoo containing this ingredient can be used at any stage, age. Selenium sulfide. This reduces production of natural oils by glands in the scalp. It is effective in treating dandruff. Zinc pyrithione. This slows down the growth of Malassezia, the yeast-like fungus. Coal tar. This has natural antifungal agent. Right? Polyphenols and dyed or treated hair may become stained by long term usage. So coal tar very rarely used now. Previously it was used because it has been used at high dosage, it has carcinogenic effect. Salicylic acid, this helps scalp to get rid of skin cells. They do not slow down the production of skin cells. Many scalp scrubs contain salicylic acid. Treatment can sometimes leave the scalp dry and make skin flaking worse. So, what is the mode of treatment? Control the fungus. Reduce the oil secretion, and 3, the flakes, the excessive growth of the skin cells, outermost cells, how can we control it? Right, three approaches, right? So, these are the common things used. Selenium sulfide shampoos are OTC products. Ketoconazole and zinc pyrithione is widely used in the anti-dandruff shampoos. Right? Some of the herbal approach, tea tree oil, rosemary oil, neem extract, basil extract, amla, fenugreek, trifla, okay. Trifla has three herbs, amla, bibitaki and haritaki, okay. These three herbs are there in trifla, right. So all these things are evaluated for dandruff. See, there are a lot of potential for research in the area of cosmeceuticals. Now, how can we get some good treatment for dandruff, right? What is the future research? Now, all the anti-dandruff shampoo, it just controls the dandruff, no? And there are no good, even selenium sulfide, it controls the dandruff. If you stop using for some time, you get the dandruff again. And if you continuously use these shampoos, it excessively dries the scalp also, right? So in 2016, there was a research which said, according to 2016 study, that bacteria, mainly Propionibacterium and Staphylococcus, Propionibacterium P. acnes, Propionibacterium acnes causes acne, right? Mainly Propionibacterium and Staphylococcus are more important to dandruff than fungi. This is another study. In 2016, there was a study which says that these two are more important than fungi. Bacterial presence was in turn influenced by water and sebum content. So water and sebum, not only the fungi which is important, which is Melazizia species, no? What they say is, bacteria had a stronger relationship with severity of dandruff than fungi. This study suggests that adjusting balance of bacteria on scalp, particularly by enhancing Propionibacterium and suppressing Staphylococcus, might be a potential solution to lessen dandruff. So, a new approach is suggested, and I was wondering whether it is 2016. Stopped by, in 2016, a paper published in 2019, right? So in that paper, the diversity and abundance of fungi and bacteria on the healthy and dandruff affected human skull, right? In that also, they reconfirm, right? The scalp microbiota of dandruff and non-dandruff were. So there were Propionibacterium, they call currently as Cutibacterium now, I don't know, they changed the name of Propionibacterium to Cutibacterium, and Staphylococcus also there, while Melazizia was the main fungal inhabitant, it was also there, these two bacteria were also there. Okay, so dandruff was associated with greater frequencies of Melazizia restricta. It's another Melazizia species and Staphylococcus species. Compared to healthy population, this was high at 95% confidence. Statistically, Melazizia restricta and Staphylococcus were more, right? Analysis also revealed that the presence of an unclassified fungal toxin that could represent a novel Melazizia species also. Now, What is the correct Malassezia species present? Okay. It also, restriction of Staphylococcus is important, right? Are we addressing correctly? Are we addressing Staphylococcus? See, what is happening here is a perfect balance of this bacteria and fungal is also important. And the imbalances causes all the problems because it's open. No, it will be the scalp is a good medium. No, it has eccrine sweat and the sebaceous secretions, right? So there should be a proper balance in the bacteria, fungi on the scalp, right? So the Staphylococcus in a dandruff patient with a dandruff, this is a new line where it might be that both antifungal and antibacterial treatment should be there for scalp, for treatment of dandruff, right? This is a new angle. So what I am telling you is a condition, all the conditions, no, there are a lot of aspects which has to be seen. Again, why suddenly there is a bacterial infection for dandruff prone people? What are the sebum composition changes? What, whether the eccrine sweat is more? No, lot of factors that has to be studied. So study on acne and the further research is required in the field of acne and dandruff, no, to get a treatment that stops acne and that stops dandruff. Current treatments, even in the terms of pharmaceutical treatment, doesn't stop it. No, it controls it, right? So that is the thought I want to leave with you on dandruff. Now, as we end my life lesson, part 26, do not be hard on yourself. Do not focus on perfection. Thank you. Thank you for listening to me. We'll meet in the next session. Till then, connect you with the next session. Till then, bye.